The current version of Dungeons & Dragons, aka 5th edition, has been out for 10 years this year. On this 10th anniversary, Wizards of the Coast, the publishers of Dungeons & Dragons, have decided they're going to come out with a new version. They haven't told us what it's called. Is it 5.5? Is it 6e? Is it D&D 1? Well, nobody really knows, but changes were needed to be made. Why? Who knows? One of the main changes that they're coming out with is a change to the racial system. Now, throughout tabletop role-playing game history, there has almost always been different races that one could choose. These races would be usually a human, and if you're in the fantasy genre, you would have elves and dwarves, halflings, gnomes, and occasionally you would get more exotic races. In the first edition of Advanced Dungeons & Dragons, way back in the 70s, there was a very clear delineation between human and other races, and this had to do with leveling. The game was very tough, and, well, your character was not likely to survive for very long. If you had a human, it would be slow going, but if you could make it over those first few levels, all of a sudden, your character started gaining a lot more abilities. If you pick something like an elf or a dwarf, you would gain other abilities that, at the start, would really help you survive. However, you had a cap on how many levels you could level up. And this was seen as the trade-off. Do you be something normal and have a higher potential, or do you take better abilities to start off with, but you're not going to be nearly as good in a higher level game? This quickly became the de facto formula for most tabletop role-playing games. Even if it wasn't a starting race per se, you would have something similar. For example, a game like Gamma World would have you a pure strain human or a mutated human or some kind of mutated animal, gaining pluses and minuses for all of those. Somewhere between the start of 5th edition and where we are now, the word race became problematic. As such, Wizards of the Coast decided, well, we're going to change this. And instead of giving bonuses on race, we're going to have different lineages. Fair enough. These different pluses and minuses to statistics and different abilities could easily be offloaded to either the character's class, aka whatever their profession is, or it could be to their background. So it would make sense that if you had a smithing background, you had extra strength and extra constitution. If you were a religious acolyte, you would have more wisdom and perhaps more intelligence from studying your religious book. The problem is, you still need that system of pluses and minuses. Unfortunately, with what's come out about the 2024 changes in quote-unquote race, there doesn't seem to be any downside at all. While they did take out bonuses and minuses to base stats such as strength, dexterity, intelligence, wisdom, constitution, they still left in the extra abilities for race. So for example, certain races will be able to see in the dark. Certain races are able to regenerate faster, don't need to eat. And then there are other abilities as well, even as simple as walking. It used to be that if you were a normal-sized human, you could walk 30 feet in 6 seconds. However, if you were a smaller creature, such as a halfling or a gnome, your speed was generally modified down to 25 or even 20 feet. This kept a difference, that there are pluses and minuses. Sure, you probably gained some spells for being a gnome, however, you would have trouble maneuvering in combat. And that was something that people had to deal with. It's really a form of resource management, which a lot of these games were built on. You had to make sure you had enough arrows and food and torches and whatnot to make it through a dungeon. And it was the same thing with what kind of character you wanted to play. Do you want to be up close and fight? Do you want to be in the back shooting things? It's really up to you and the pluses and the minuses of how you want to play a character. Unfortunately, in D&D 2024, everybody moves 30 feet. Humans still don't get any bonuses to seeing things in the dark or extra resistances to damage. So why would anybody want to pick a human instead of any of the other races. To paraphrase Dash Parr from The Incredibles, when everyone is special, no one is special. And this really hurts the worlds that people are in. For the most part, all of these special races were considered rare and extraordinary if you actually met them. The vast majority of people were human. It was a lot of fun. It gave a sense of wonder and excitement. As much as I hate to criticize the way other people like to play their tabletop role-playing games, this, however, does affect the game as a whole by not making the game as fun. And if it's not as fun, why are people going to want to play? For the long-term survivability of Dungeons & Dragons, it needs to get back to its spiritual roots, if not the mechanical roots. You need the three pillars plus one: combat, exploration, and social interaction. And as much as I hate to say it, the fourth one is resource management. Now, while we don't always want to have to deal with every tiny little thing, the more of that you take away, the more choice and agency players have taken away. Their ability to make unique characters is, well, diminished. Effectively, what's the difference between playing a 9-foot-tall Goliath and a 3-foot-tall halfling if there's no difference in the statistics? While it's difficult to say exactly what outside of money were the reasons for developing a quote-unquote new version of D&D based on the 5e rule system, it's very clear that one thing is happening. In order to please everyone, they're effectively pleasing no one. And it would be a shame to see a game as lovely as D&D go down in popularity due to this mess. But hey, if you want an exciting game based on D&D 5e, why don't you check out my campaign guide, Empire of the Undying Sun, a horror campaign that takes you from, hey, there's something in the woods, to swashbuckling pirate adventures, to exploring lost civilizations in the desert and in the jungle, to finally having to make a choice that will change the fate of the world. Go check out Empire of the Undying Sun at www.empireoftheundyingsun.com or check out our pre-launch page on Kickstarter. We'll be launching in late September.